Yeah, is it showing now?
Hi Krishna, hi Samvat sir. Yes, Vrijilesh, I guess.
Hello, man.
Yeah.
Your screen is there.
Yes. Is it showing now?
Hi Krishna, hi Samvat sir.
Yeah, is it showing now?
Hi Krishna, yes, hi Samvat sir.
Yes,
Vrijilesh. I guess.
Hello, man. Yeah. Hello, boss.
Your screen is there.
Yes. Okay, so I'll also just one second. Just... Hey, is it showing now?
Hi Krishna, hi Samvat sir.
Yeah, is it showing now?
Hi Krishna, hi Samvat sir.
Yes,
Vrijilesh. I guess.
Hello, man. Yeah. Hello, boss.
Your screen is there.
Yes. Okay, so I'll also just one second. Just... Hey, is it showing now?
Hi Krishna, hi Samvat sir.
Yeah, is it showing now?
Hi Krishna, hi Samvat sir.
Yes,
Vrijilesh. I guess.
Hello, man.
Yeah.
Hello, boss.
Your screen is there.
Yes. Okay, so I'll also just one second. Just... Hey, is it showing now?
Hi Krishna, hi Samvat sir.
Yeah, is it showing now?
Hi Krishna, hi Samvat sir.
Yes,
Vrijilesh. I guess.
Hello, man.
Yeah,
hello, boss.
Your screen is there.
Yes. Okay, so I'll also just.
Good morning, everyone.
Hi Krishna, hi Samvat sir.
Is it showing now?
Hi Krishna.
Mind one of us. Typing that yes, it is okay.
Ashish, are you?
People on YouTube.
Are you able to see on YouTube?
We are able to see on YouTube, Vrijilesh.
Ashish, Arvind, can you just put the first slide and share?
Yeah, please. I'll do that. So is it okay now, Vrijilesh? I'm sharing my Google Earth screen.
Yeah, I'm just looking at.
Yes, sir, we can see that.
People on YouTube streaming, are you able to see my screen?
Yes. Yes, Arvind, please go ahead. Arvind, you can go ahead.
Thanks, Vrijilesh. So, good morning, everyone. Happy Sunday. This is first of a two-part series on the Bengal-Assam rail connections. This will be entirely through Google Earth screen sharing mode. If you are conversant with the satellite image mode, I would recommend that you have another window for Google Maps or Google Earth app open in your screen, and then you can also follow as we discuss. It will add more to the interest quotient. It is not a requirement. It is just a supplement. So I will start with an introduction to the concept called USB. All along we have been learning USB as the universal serial bus, a computer concept, but then there is another USB that will be very interesting during this session, which is the United States of Bengal. So we are now going to probably late 1800s, where we have our country without any boundaries here. This is the area that you see on the screen is primarily focused around Bengal. The mouse pointer points at Bengal area. This is the Assam area, and this is the UP, the Gangetic Plains.
Arvind, there is some feedback. Is your speaker on? If your speaker is on, please switch it off. There is some feedback.
No, Ashish.
So I don't know where that some feedback is. Anyway, you continue. That is low volume. Just go ahead.
Okay. So this is the USB, the Bengal without any boundaries here. So right now, this area, what we see here, this stretch is the West Bengal of India. And this stretch, the greener one, is right now Bangladesh. As part of these two sessions, we will understand what were the railway links between Bengal and Assam in late 1800s and early 1900s. And in the second session, we will get to know what happened after partition. So the first session, we will concentrate on the early railway lines up to and what happened during the partition in 1947. So there are a few things that we will be discussing on and off during the session. I will probably give a brief introduction to those up front. So we will not touch upon them every time as we discuss. One, this is River Ganga. The red line that you see here is River Ganga. It enter on the top left screen. This is Haridwar, where it enters the plains and then it flows through Uttar Pradesh, goes through Varanasi, Patna, Bengal, and it joins the Bay of Bengal in Sundarbans. So Ganga River is of prime importance for this session because as a default rule, while the early railway lines were laid, anything to the south and west of Ganga River was broad gauge up to Varanasi. Anything to the north and east of Ganga River was meter gauge. So this difference in the gauges was an important factor that influenced a lot of decisions down the line. We will discuss them in greater detail as we go along the session. But this is Ganga River for you. Anything down in the screen, southwest, is BG, and anything up in the screen is or was MG. Now, we have a concept of the right bank and the left bank for a river. A right bank is while we are following the course of the river, for Ganga, from the left to the right, anything on this side is a right bank, anything on this side, the top side, is left bank. So I'll be using this right bank and left bank very frequently. So this is the explanation for that. Now what we see on the screen, a couple of geographical features that I would like to highlight. The white color line that you see here, the snow cliffs, are the Himalayan ranges. So this is Himalayas. On top of Himalayas is the Tibetan plateau. This is Nepal. Roughly this area is Nepal. This is Bhutan. This is the Brahmaputra Valley. You can see it going through between the Himalayan ranges and the Kasi Jaintia Hills here. So this is the Brahmaputra Valley. Brahmaputra flows to the Bengal region and it joins the Bay of Bengal. This is Ganga Plain. Just a brief background on the history of the rivers, three rivers that we are going to discuss today. Ganga, the line that we saw here, Kosi, which is actually flowing here right now, and Brahmaputra are the three main rivers that dominated this region. Probably 100-150 years ago, these three were separate rivers flowing into the Sundarbans, the delta region here. Ganga used to flow this way through Calcutta as what we call Bhagirathi now, and it joined the Bay of Bengal. While Kosi and Tista River, which is another important river that we will be discussing in this forum, Tista River and Kosi River joined, and then they went through the Bangladesh area to join the Bay of Bengal. And third one was the Brahmaputra, which joined Bay of Bengal separately. So one fine day, probably, God knows what happened, an earthquake happened, and these two rivers, Kosi and Tista, started to shift their flow. Kosi, while Kosi moved westward and started to join Ganga, Tista moved eastward and started to join Brahmaputra here. So then Ganga and Brahmaputra also changed their courses. They joined together While Ganga is known as Padma in Bangladesh region, after Brahmaputra joins, it is called as Meghna and it joins the Bay of Bengal. That is how these rivers are as of date. So as always with any geographical feature, while we fly back to our 6th and 7th standards, learning how to draw maps, color maps. So the green is a plateau, green is a plain. The lines that we see here are the rivers, the what we call maroon, chocolate color region here are the plateaus. White is a snow-capped mountain, and then these are the snow plateaus in the Tibetan region. So these are the introduction part. Any questions at this point, Vrijesh? Anything from the comment section?
Arvind, is your link to Google YouTube also on? You can switch that off or make the sound zero on that. That could be a reason why there is a feedback. Just check that out.
I have muted that, Ashish.
Okay.
Just give me a second. Let me check if there are any other mic or speaker systems on. Just a second, please. Is it better now, Ashish?
Yeah, we will know after 5 seconds.
Okay.
Okay, go ahead now.
I'll proceed. Yeah. So, we will start with stage one. This is where we have the lines prior to 1947. I'll go in stages. So, first stage, we have a couple of locations that we will be discussing. We will start with Kolkata. The capital of British Raj. So Sialdah on the left bank of Bhagirathi River is our starting point for this discussion. What happened? So we will start step by step. Now if I at that stage early 1900s or late 1800s, if I have to travel from Bengal to Assam, by Assam I also mean the North Bengal area that we have now, Darjeeling, Siliguri areas, and then we have our Alipurduar and the Duars area, and then the Guwahati area, and then Tinsukia, Dibrugarh area. So these four are the major points where we have places of commercial interest in Assam, North Bengal. So if I have to travel from Sialdah, so how do I travel? I'll first take a broad gauge train from Sialdah to a place called Poradaha. So this is the BG line. It starts from Sialdah station. It goes via Ranaghat, Jede to Poradaha. As you see here, this is Padma River or Ganga River. This is Brahmaputra. They join here. A bit upstream is where we have this place called Poradaha. Now you might wonder, why are we not going near the river? One pertinent point to note is that the rivers are flowing in plains and they don't have any hills or mountains to regulate their flow, so they are at their free will to flow wherever they want, depending on the flood levels. So it is always better to leave a window open, because the rivers might expand their banks, they may breach their banks, come into the plains area as well. So even if you see here, the Ganga River, although it appears to have been flowing here within this smaller narrow margin window, you can see that it has breached its banks and it has crossed all the way till this point at one stage, right? So the difference in terrain is a clear indication that the river is capable of expanding its boundaries at any time. So it is always better that you stop your railhead somewhere near the river, but a bit far away, so that you don't have your railway properties getting damaged due to one flood or the other. So this place, Poradaha, was the end point of the BG line at that point, while the line was laid. And then people were ferried through a bus from Horadaha to a place called Damukia Ghat. So this is Damukia Ghat. You can see that this is probably in this area the most narrow area where you can cross the river. So Damukia Ghat is where people will be getting down from a bus. And once you get down from a bus, you will be taken to a ferry across the Padma River to a place on the left bank, which is Saraghat. So the ferries usually had two levels of accommodation in the steamer boat. The lower level is where the third class and the interclass people were bunched. There were no proper seating arrangements. The upper level, the upper deck will have a partition for the first class and the second class. Sometimes there used to be separate enclosures for military personnel as well. So from Damukia Ghat to Saraghat, I'll be taking a steamer. And once I get down at Saraghat, I will be taking a meter gauge train, which will take me up through the Bengal region to the Assam. So from Saraghat, the meter gauge line ran through a place called Atrai, and then another major town called Parbatipur. So friends, please remember this place, Parbatipur. We will be understanding the importance of this point at a later stage during our session. But this place played a vital role in framing some of our decisions. So from Parbatipur, the meter gauge line proceeded straight through Jalpaiguri, which is the place where it turns a bit left to the west side, and then it went to Siliguri town, SGUT. So as you see, Siliguri is on the foothills of the Himalayas, and then Darjeeling, where the British collectors and the British governors, the high-level officials used to spend their summer, had a narrow gauge line built from Siliguri to Darjeeling. So this is the first link that we have from Sialdah to Darjeeling through Poradaha, Saraghat, Atrai, Parbatipur and Siliguri. I will pause here. Vrijlesh, any questions on the comments window?
Yeah, Arvind, there are a couple of them, Arvind. I'll just read out to you in case you... Would you want to take them now?
Anything relating to this line? Yes, we will answer. General ones, probably we can park them and take them up as one bunch.
No, I think most of it is answered by, for example, Ganesh Iyer has answered a couple of questions. So, I don't think we need to wait right now. We'll just go ahead.
Okay. So, on the Assam front, the west side of it, the North Bengal side, is covered through this line. Now we'll see how Guwahati and Tinsukia, Dibrugarh areas are connected to Sialdah, the capital. So while we are here, I'll switch on the next set of places that we will be discussing. Between Atrai and Parbatipur, there is a junction called Santahar. At Santahar, there is a meter gauge branch line which branched to the east, flowing along, going along the upstream of Brahmaputra, Tista and Torsha rivers. So now this line, initially it went across the Tista river. Earlier, while the line was built, initial days they had a Tista river ferry as well, but then there was a big bridge that was built across the river. As we discuss here, you can always notice that in the screen, usually the bridges are built at a point where the river is technically called as trained, which means they have understood where the river is at its narrow width, where it is easy for us from a cost of construction perspective and from a breach of bank perspective, where it is safe. So even if it is a few kilometers here and there, it was always a point that the bridge will be built at where the river is trained. Now, after we cross the Tista River, we have another river called Singmari, That is where we play. Have a place called Mughal Hut Ghat. Now, this Mughal Hut Ghat initially had a meter gauge line crossing the river through a series of bridges with the river islands here, and then moving to a place called Gital Daha, which is right now in India. The bridge was broken due to severe floods. It was not rebuilt. It was abandoned. And then Singimari River ferry was brought in from Mughal Hut Ghat to Gital Daha Ghat. So this ferry service was introduced. So people used to get down at Mughal Hut Ghat, hop onto a ferry, hop off on the other left bank side and move on to Gital Daha. The meter gauge train to Guwahati will be waiting here at the Gital Daha station. And then there is a long journey from Gital Daha to a place called Amingaon. I'll just zoom out a bit. As you see, the geographical features are pretty interesting here. You can see, we can even have a competition on who counts or the number of tributaries that flow into the Brahmaputra on its right bank. So this is Tisha, Singamari, Tosha, and a bunch of almost 20-30 tributaries. Some of them very small. The lines are not visible at this zoom level. But then there are a lot of bridges that are built, and this line took us to a place called Amingaon, which is near Guwahati. You can see it on the right side of the screen. Now I will straight away go to this place called Amingaon. Since we are on the right side of Brahmaputra River and Guwahati is here on the left bank of Brahmaputra, we will require a place to cross the river. As you can see, this is where the mountains are, small hills I would call. This is the Kamakhya Hill and this is the Amingaon Hill. So between these two hills is where Brahmaputra flows. There is a little risk, less risk that Brahmaputra will breach its bank here, because it is protected by rising hills on the either side. So this is place was thought it is the best to cross the Brahmaputra. So the line ended here, Amingaon, and then Amingaon to Pandu was a very famous steamer link. So once people got down from Amingaon station here, they will walk to the ferry station or the ghat starting point. They will cross the river here and reach a place called Pandu. Pandu is on the left bank. So a meter gauge train will wait for us here. From Pandu, it will take us through to Guwahati. These are the Pandu-Guwahati shuttles available even as late as late 1970s timetables. It would be nice to see the timetables that are uploaded in the IRFCA forums. Links are given there. Google Drive links are given there. When time permits, you can always take a look at the train. Usually when we see timetables, it will have an arrival and departure time for a station for a train. However, for these, you will have a train arrival and a steamer departure for Amingaon, and a steamer arrival and a train departure at Pandu, which is quite unusual for people who are born after 80s. It would be a nice thing to view in timetables. Okay, now we are now at Guwahati. Center point of Assam, Brahmaputra Valley, I would say. Now, what are the options that I have for us to go to the eastern side of it, the oil-rich areas of Dibrugarh, Tinsukia, and the foothills to the China border, Arunachal. Now, let's come back to our Poradaha. So, I have an option here from Poradaha. The line was extended to a place called Golondo. This place, Golondo, was one of the busiest places in Bangladesh or Bengal at that point of time. Golondo Ghat was the place where people used to get down and cross the combined Ganga and Brahmaputra rivers to go to the eastern side of Bengal and get a connection to go to Dhaka, Chittagong, and other Silat and other areas of East Bengal. Now, while I am at Golondo, my broad gauge train will drop me at this ghat. As you see, this is more strategically good place because you don't have to cross Ganga and Brahmaputra twice. You'll have to cross their combined river stream only once. So once at Golondo, I take a Padma River ferry. I go downstream. This ferry is for around 6 to 7 hours journey to a place called Chandpur. And from Chandpur, I have a direct train to Lumding. So this train, as you see, these are on the right side of this line are the Kachar Hills, inside which we have our Tripura, Mizoram, and the southern Assam areas, the Barak Valley. So from Chandpur, my train takes all the way up north. It crosses the Kachar Hills at their northernmost point, just south of the Khasi and Jaintia Hills, where my Meghalaya state is right now. And then it starts to enter the Barak Valley here. The Barak Valley, this small piece of detour is the half long. It was in the meter gauge line, but however, the broad gauge line now bypasses this half long hill altogether. It takes a direct line here, enters the Barak Valley, and then it goes along the river and reaches this place, Lumding. Now, Lumding or Lumding, depending on the pronunciation. I have two options. I can take a train to Guwahati on the western side, a meter gauge train, or I have an option to take a meter gauge train on the eastern side, my right hand side, all the way from Lumding to Tinsukia. Just north of Tinsukia here is Dibrugarh along the Brahmaputra River. I always had a question on why there is no direct line from Guwahati to Dibrugarh. Why it should, you know, travel down south all the way to Lumding and then climb all the way up north to go to Tinsukia. One of the reasons is how these two towns or cities were connected to the capital city at that point of time. This is the shortest way possible. And the direct transport facilities from Guwahati to Tinsukia were taken care of by the Brahmaputra ferry system itself. It was more powerful than the meter gauge lines. So that is why we have these lines traveling down south, meeting at Lumding, more like a stethoscope. Okay. So Vrijlesh, I'll pause here again. Any specific questions on these lines?
I'll just read out a couple of them. Okay, so basically we were asked about Saraighat area, and Ganesh Iyer has actually responded to that. Similarly, Anirudh has also responded about the state of affairs in the BG conversion in 1926. Ganesh Iyer also mentions about Saraighat, where AHOMS under Lachit Bahadur Khan routed the Mughals was under Mir Jumla. He goes through a little bit of history out there.
Okay.
The statue of Lalit Bahadur Khan at the place where the bridge takes off. So there is.
Let me clarify one point up front, Vrijlesh. It would be good if we do not jump the gun right now.
Right.
Because we are right now talking about the original connections in late 1800s and early 1900s.
Right.
The Saraighat bridge and other stuff will be covered as part of the session 2, where we will be talking extensively about how these lines got connected through the integrated BG system.
Right.
So we will pause those questions for the moment. Sure. Any questions on the NG connections?
No, nothing much.
Arvind, I have a question.
Yes, Ashish.
One first question is, you mentioned that there was a 6 hour long journey for the ferry. So this, could that Chandpur station, equivalent of that on the other side, could it not have been a little bit upstream to reduce the ferry journey because trains are faster than, or the geography was such that you couldn't have it further up?
One zoom in will give you the answers, Ashish. Look at the system here. imagine how many bridges we'll have to build in this unpredictable area. Look at how the river has flown over a period. There are numerous smaller streams here. Okay, we will never know when this river will change its course. This will become a smaller river, and probably this will become the largest river. Right? This happened in Patna. That will be probably a topic for another session. That happened in Patna, where the near Patna area, where the entire meter gauge line had to be shifted probably 15-20 kilometers on the left bank of Ganga, because the Ganga river breached, and what was once a smaller river became the main river, and what was once the main river became a smaller tributary. So these
another related question is this ferry timings for going along the stream and going against the stream, are they same or are they different in the timetable?
Frankly, I should admit, I expected this question. I did not have time to get the answer. Someone who has access to the 1970 All India timetable or 77 All India timetable, they can probably get the answer. Or if we have DSP Anirudh on YouTube live streaming, he should be able to answer. We will give him a couple of minutes.
One more One more thing, Arvind. If you could mention the distances between these two, whichever two points you are pointing out, that will be helpful. For example, between Golondo and Chandpur, you said it takes 6 hours in a ferry. What is the actual distance?
Interesting suggestion, Brijesh. What I will do? What I will do is, after this session, I will take a screenshot of this entire system.
Okay.
I will add the kilometer markings, and then I will post it as an image file. You can probably put it on the server.
Right. Thanks a lot. Now you can continue, Arvind.
Yeah, we will move on to the next set of stations. So, now we have discussed about the main lines here. We will now slowly move on to the branch lines. I was mentioning one word, Duars. The Duars is this area on the foothills of the Himalayas along the right bank of Brahmaputra. This area is called Duars, which is very fertile, which is a complete forest area, rich in flora and fauna, so which naturally attracts a lot of people who want to probably do hunting or want to take leisure time vacations. So this area was very famous even at that point of time. Mal is one town which was the what I would call a center point for the Duars area that we see here. So how was Mal connected? So initially, since the line, we need to understand one point here. Railway lines is not just marking lines on maps. It involves actual construction and cost, money that needs to be financed, right? So railway lines are laid in the shortest distance possible and feasible from a financial perspective. And wherever lines are laid, it will be branched out or it will be connected to the existing lines as much as possible. So instead of building a new line altogether to Mal, the existing line anyway has connections to Jalpaiguri here. So from Jalpaiguri, we will be expected to walk down to a place called Karlaghat, cross the Teesta River with a ferry, Karlaghat to Bansghat, and then there was a meter gauge line from Bansghat to Mal via Damohani. So this is how Mal got connected. And further connections, once the Teesta River was unpredictable, even now it is unpredictable, during monsoon seasons and when the river was flowing uncontrollably, the ferry system had to be stopped and people were losing their connection. So what was thought was, anyway, we have a bridge over the Teesta River downstream here at its one of its narrowest narrow points. So why don't we take a branch after the line crosses here and then take along the river to somewhere connecting somewhere here around Damohani. So that was taken care of, and a new line was built from a place called Lamonirhat all the way to Damohani via Bansghat. So this way, there was only one ferry steamer crossing, the famous one at Saragat, Padma River crossing. Apart from this, there were no other river crossings, and people were able to take a single train all the way to Mal. Now, I was mentioning about the unpredictable nature of Teesta River. As you see here, this entire area here was prone to flooding. So this line once got washed out. So a cord line was built at Damohani, a bit farther away on its right bank. So this cord line was serving the main line to Mal for a long time. At this point of time, the only steamer connections that people were forced to take were along the Ganga River at Saragat and Brahmaputra River at Guwahati. So there was a pressing need to build bridges along these points so that there is a uninterrupted railway connection. More importantly, even if there are any heavy military equipment that need to be moved, they need not be transported across regular ferries. The trains themselves will be able to transport them seamlessly. So that was one of the pressing reasons to build a bridge along these two rivers. So the first one was the Hardinge Bridge. The Hardinge Bridge was built between Damukia Ghat and on the other side of the Padma River. And then it was laid as a BG line all the way up to Trai and Santahar. Santahar is where we saw that the lines branch out for Darjeeling and Guwahati. So it was laid as a parallel line along Trai all the way up to Santahar. And in the meantime, the line from Poradaha to Damukia Ghat, the roadway was also converted as a broad gauge line. So now we have a seamless connection, rail connection, without ferry from Sialdah, the capital city, all the way to Santahar, where you will switch, or Trai, where you will switch from BG trains to meter gauge trains. And then you will move all the way straight up to Siliguri or to Mal. The only ferry connection left was Guwahati between Amingaon and Pandu. Over a period, the Golondor to Chandpur was found to be a lot time consuming, obviously, and also it takes a circuitous route. So people did not prefer this. They always preferred the Santahar route, and all the main, the premium trains always took this meter gauge line on the right bank of Brahmaputra. Now, I was mentioning in my earlier post that my scope of this session will also cover Katihar, which is one of the most important nodes, I would call, for the connection between Bengal and the rest of India on its west side. So we will see how Katihar was connected to Sialdah. I am right now ignoring the eastern railway part from Howrah. I'll just take us through the proper Bengal part of the railway lines. So from Sialdah, our broad gauge train will take a turn at Ranaghat, and then it will move upstream along the left bank of Bhagirathi River. You can see it here. The Bhagirathi River is also known as Hooghly. It goes to a place called Lalgola, which is a busy terminus even as of date. And at Lalgola is a ferry across the Ganga River. You will go to a place called Godagari Ghat. And from Godagari Ghat, as always, it is on the northeast side of Ganga. So obviously, there is a meter gauge line all the way to Katihar via Malda. So this is how trains connected Sialdah and Katihar. One important point that I'll have to emphasize at this point is the meter gauge coaches coupling mechanism. As we all know, broad gauge trains can be coupled any way. That is, if there are two ends of a coach, for example, if the right side is called as end A and the left side is called as end B, end A of one BG coach can be connected to either end A or end B of another BG coach. In fact, there is no difference. Both the ends are the same, so they can be coupled anyway. Whereas this is not possible in a meter gauge coach. Meter gauge coach has two different couplers at either end. One is called, for our purposes, we will call it as a coupler A, and the other is called a coupler B. So a coupler A can be connected only to coupler B, and a coupler B can be connected only to coupler A. So it is a sequence. If you turn a coach from one side to another, then these coaches will not cannot be coupled. It's like, for say, simple understanding purposes, it is like the north and south pole of a magnet. So north and north don't couple. So meter gauge coaches, the north end and the north end won't couple. Because of how the lines are branching out of Bengal, when the trains go all the way to Guwahati side here, let us assume the A end is on the west side and B end is on the west. A end is on the east side and B end is on the west side. Whereas if I am traveling towards Katihar, my A end is on the west side and B end is on the east side. So these coaches, when they go to Katihar and Guwahati, they will be facing opposite sides. If I have to travel from Katihar to Guwahati without disturbing this arrangement, I will require a reversal midway. It is a compulsory one because otherwise it will have marshalling issues in replacing some sick coaches or whatever at either end, and it will be a huge confusion. You will have coaches, but you will not have adequate amount of time and energy and infrastructure to turn these coaches and then make them fit for coupling with other coaches. So a reversal was then planned at Parbatipur. So any train from Katihar to Parbatipur will have a reversal here. See, the line joins on the opposite side, and from Parbatipur you will reverse and go. So the alignment will be very similar to how the trains are coming out of Atrai and Santahar. And then even the line that goes to Guwahati will involve a reversal, and it will go all the way to Moghalghat. And then it will go all the way to Guwahati. So this reversal was inevitable because of how the meter gauge coaches have their couplings. Now we will park this Parbatipur for another important decision in down the line. Remember that it doesn't stop here. Parbatipur, in fact, played a very, very vital role in how the lines are designed post independence, the Assam Link Railway, which we will cover in phase two of our session. So I will pause here before we move on to branches, the branch lines, smaller branch lines that we will touch upon before we get into the stages where it is set for independence. Any questions at this stage, Vrijlesh? Any questions on whatever we have covered till now? Ashish, Vrijlesh?
Yeah, 1 second. So there is a question that is Parbatipur a four road junction?
Yes, it is. As you can see here, Parbatipur was a four road junction. It is here. One line to Sialdah, one line to Guwahati, one line to Katihar and Kanpur, Lucknow, and one line up north to Siliguri and Darjeeling.
There are a few comments about the interesting info about MG coaches. I don't think that is a new info which Arvind has provided. I think if you go through the IRFCF FAQs, you will have an idea about all of those.
It in fact has many much more details than what I shared.
Correct. One more question about, was Pandu once a headquarter of any FR?
Exactly, yes. NFR headquarters was at Pandu.
Yes, I think we can go ahead now.
Okay, I will cover Ganesh a couple
Ayer,
of brands.
Ganesh Ayer adds one more info. Parvatipur has a diesel shed.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yes, you can continue, Arvind.
Okay, so now we will move on to the branch lines, smaller branch lines. A couple of stations that have now been enabled in the view. We will move on to the branches. Okay, so for the Darjeeling Hill Railway, there was an extension that was planned all the way to Kishanganj, KNE. So it did not actually branch out at Siliguri. It branched out at a point called Panchnai, and the line branched out from the southern end, which indicates the dominance that Darjeeling had against the foothill station Siliguri. So even though Siliguri is a bigger town and other stuff, Darjeeling had the dominance and the line branched out from Panchnai. So from Darjeeling side. So from Panchnai, it came all the way through Bagdogra, Naxalbari, and then all the way through Alohabari and to Kishanganj here. I'm not sure about why this extension to Darjeeling Hill Railway was built as a narrow gauge at that stage. Probably there were some commercial reasons, so I'll skip that part. So this line got built as a narrow gauge. And then there was a meter gauge line that was built from Kishanganj to a place called Barsoi. So again, you can look at the dominance that Parbatipur had on Katihar side. The line branched out from Barsoi without a reversal for Parbatipur side. So any train that is coming from Katihar side will have to undergo a reversal. And then there was another branch line that was built from Siliguri to Kalimpong along the Teesta Valley. This line went all the way up north from Siliguri, crossing a couple of tributaries of Teesta. And then it went all the way to Kalimpong along this valley. The reason that I am not able to trace a line here is the line does not exist right now. It was totally washed away by heavy floods a century ago. And then at Mal, there were a couple of branch lines that were planned. One was to a place called Udlabari. You can see why the lines have stopped here. It is because they have to build three bridges, and this was meter gauge and that was narrow gauge, so it was incompatible. These were rivers that were prone for flooding, and we don't know when they will change their courses. So as much as possible, it was restricted to places along the banks. Now, even here, this is a classic example. You can see how the river was trained. It was the bridge was built at a place where the river is at narrow width area. Again, there was a big line that was built, meter gauge line from Mal all the way to a place called Rajabhat Kawa, RVK, along the Doors. This, I would say, was one of the adventurous construction activities that were that was undertaken by the Bengal Railways. It almost crossed all the rivers. There were almost 50-60 bridges that were built, smaller bridges and major bridges, built across all the tributaries that come along from the Himachal area to a place called Rajabhat Kawa. This is the Duars line, as it is called now. The broad gauge line is pretty scenic in this area. And then there is a branch line to Meteli, which is now abandoned. And then there is one of the longest narrow gauge lines from a place called Jayanti inside the Duars forest area all the way to Rajabhat Kawa, Alipur Duar, which was one of the prominent places at district headquarters at that point of time, to Cooch Behar, and all the way up to Gitaldaha. So Alipur Duar was connected to the mainline system, the meter gauge system, via an extensive narrow gauge system that took all the way to Jayanti. And then there's a small branch line that was built from Golakganj to Dubri Ghat, And then there's another smaller branch from Lataguri to Ramshai through the forest area. These are now abandoned. The Ramshai area passes through forest area. It is now abandoned. The Jayanti line passes through forest line and it is now abandoned. And then to avoid bunching of trains at Katihar, because all the trains from, remember, Lucknow, Kanpur, Varanasi, these trains were coming in through Katihar only. So to avoid bunching of trains at Katihar, there was a cord that was built between Kumedpur and Mukuria. So this is where it stood just before the independence. So I'll just take off the station names for a minute, so you'll get an idea on the entire network. Just to recall, red is broad gauge, green is meter gauge, and yellow is narrow gauge. So this is how it was at the point of independence. Okay, we will now move on to what happened during independence, where the borders got cut off. As they say, the world map without borders, that is how it was. But then due to some reasons, the partition happened in Bengal. Now, what happened during partition? All these black color polygons that you see here are where the lines are cut. Anything inside this circle area, what I'm showing here, I'll mark it. Anything inside this area was Bangladesh. This is Bangladesh, and outside of it was India. So this is how the lines got cut. For me, you know, if I'm a manager of this railway system network, I will be totally worried because my important connections all have been cut off. The Bengal to Assam. If I have to take a train from Sialda to Jalpaiguri or Guwahati or Tinsukia, my Rana Ghat line has got cut. Even if I have to take the line through Lalgola Ghat, Godagari Ghat, the Padma River between Lalgola and Godagari was the border between India and Bangladesh. Again, if I have to come down from Malda side, the line after Malda got cut, this is where the border was. Important nodal point Parbatipur got into Bangladesh, and the line from Katihar to Bangladesh got cut. The line from Parbatipur to Siliguri got cut. This branch line, which served as a through line to Mal, it got cut here. And then the lines to Guwahati got cut at two places. And then this line from Chandpur, it got cut here, somewhere near Karimganj. So all these important connections have been snapped. Not just from a railway perspective, from India as a country, from a defense strategy perspective, if I'm not able to move my military personnel, my tankers or anything at that point of time, at you know, disturbing times, If my seamless connectivity is lost, it is very dangerous for the sovereignty of the country. So that is where Assam Link Railway concept was formed. We will go through Assam Link Railway and the subsequent Project Unigauge broad gauge lines as part of our session 2. But this is where we will leave in session 1. What happened during partition. So this is where I will pause for session 1. Brijlesh, any questions? We will probably open up the session for any questions that people may have.
So Ganesh here asked, when was Fakiragram Dhubri built?
Fakiragram Dhubri, no. the line from Dhubri went all the way, the BG line now goes all the way from Gauripur to Jogikopa. The Fakiragram to Golakganj was part of the MG main line itself. This is where it was. I'll show you. The place where the bridge, the line crosses the bridge, the branch out point is Golakganj, and somewhere here is where Fakiragram is. It was part of the main line itself. There was no direct line from Fakiragram to Dhubri. It was only to Golakganj. You will have to switch trains at Golakganj to go to Dhubri.
Okay. One more thing, Ara, when you just put up screenshots, can you add the international boundaries? So that will help us in locating it more exactly.
I will show it now just for reference.
Okay.
While I take the screenshot, I'll ensure that the border is there. The border seems to be a bit clumsy here.
Yeah.
That is okay. Enabled now.
Right.
But the yellow line that you see here is the border. And that is why I have consciously marked these in black color.
Right.
So that will give you an idea on where the lines are cut.
Yes.
The connection was snapped.
Yeah. So, if you can just open the YouTube link also, you can go through the comments, sir.
Okay, I'll just stop sharing for a moment.
Okay.
So I switch screens.
Ashish, would you like to add something?
No, Vigilesh. I mean, I was also looking at the questions, but you have covered them.
More than me, Anirudh DSP and Ganesh Iyer have covered.
Yeah. I think maybe more than Arvind.
Yeah. So, thanks Ganesh and Anirudh.
There is one question from VSP. When the connections got snapped, how people traveled? That is the topic for our next session, the part 2, VSP, sir. I guess the comments will be visible even after we end the live stream. So I will provide answers after this session, Vrijesh. I'll go through all the comments.
Yes.
I will provide the answers.
Yes.
And I think in the thread that in which the webinar is mentioned, people can members can ask questions in that as well, I guess.
Yes, on the IRFCA forum.
There is one from Manohar Natarajan. Given the nature of the terrain, it is amazing that the region was so well connected by rail ferry. What was the primary reason for this? The broader answer for BG versus MG is, sir, because of the policy decision of East India Company and the British Raj, they don't want or they didn't want local national companies, railway lines or the military movement to happen in their lines. It should involve a transshipment. So even in case of any uprising or any trouble in the region, British troops will be able to move faster and Indian local troops will not be able to move. So that was the reason that all the lines built by East India Company and the British Raj, trunk lines, were always broad gauge. Anything that local companies in India built were always in meter gauge.
Arvind, did this line go further to Burma?
No, there was no direct link from Tinsukia side to Burma. The line ended at Lekapani. But then there was a road connection from Lekapani to somewhere just next to Burma border, from where you had meter gauge trains.
And the railway lines in Burma are like north-south to align with the Irrawaddy Valley?
Yes, it is. Irrawaddy Valley, north-south connection, yes, correct. How many of the cross-border lines exist even today, Arvind Subramaniam? That's the topic for next session, part 2. We will cover it extensively in part 2. Okay, we are at 11:32. Probably last minute or two, and then we can wrap up the session. I'll hand it over to you, Vrijesh and Ashish.
So, Vrijilesh, shall we close?
Yeah.
Unless there are any more questions.
Yeah. If there are any more questions, you can just type right now. So, if there are no more questions in the next couple of minutes, I think we can just close the session for the day.
Yeah, it was really great. And the fact comes, what I'm impressed is, I'm not sure how much Arvind has traveled in that region, but otherwise it's really great that somebody from Chennai has done such a deep study of railway lines which are not in his backyard.
I have traveled only through Google Maps, Ashish. I haven't been there.
I thought as much.
East of Kolkata.
That's really amazing. Very impressive.
Okay. Thank you, friends. Thanks to IRFCA team for providing this opportunity for another interesting webinar. I guess what Vrijilesh had mentioned, the eyes open, ears open, as well as maps open would have been a bit different for you. I'm sure it was interesting as well. We will pause here and then connect in our part two. Vrijilesh and Ashish, the moderators team, will be sharing the link for the next session shortly, as and when it is ready. So thanks again. Happy weekend, everyone.
Yeah, and one more addition. You will be able to view this video later on also. So if you want, you can just go back, have a recap of this. And then if you have any queries, you can post it either on the IRFCA forum or in the comments here, which Arvind can get back with the answers after that.
All right. So Vrijilesh, will you stop the streaming now?
Yeah, I will stop the streaming now.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you so much, everyone.